Yo, this is Deontay the Bronze, Bubba Wilder, heavyweight champion of the world, and you're watching Real Fans Real Talk.
Face facts, what up?
RealFansRealTalk.com, where Arthur Thomas, Trip Young, and intern Tom, for the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend a CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. RealFansRealTalk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Is Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log onto the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell a Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter. Tuning in should be the only thing on your agenda. Certified cosign. You know what I'm about, son. RealFansRealTalk.com. I'm out one. Real fans, real talk. Real fans, real talk. Real fans, real talk.com. Real fans, real talk.com. Real fans, real talk. Real fans, real talk. Real fans, real talk.com. Real fans, real talk.com.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another live edition of Real Fans, Real Talk. I'm Mark the Statman Skevich. We got a great show lined up for you tonight. A lot going on in the world of sports, a lot going on in the world in general, and we have a packed set for tonight's show. Of course, I'm alongside Trip Young. We have our special guest, the attorney Angel Castro, and of course, Ladybug, off of the suspension, gets a promotion, and is actually starting off the program with us.
See, the Knicks need to pick me up, too.
The NBA is signing people for big deals, so maybe they'll look that up. But as usual, I'll pass it off to my co-host, the one and only Trip Young. What's going on, Trip?
I mean, it's a lot of things, like you said, has been going on in the world this week. And as you mentioned, we did put together this panel. Angel, welcome to the program. He is our legal representation for the day because we want to see, you know, how the law can actually help out with what's going on over the past week and a half with all of these shootings, the police officers in Dallas, out in Sterling, and Baton Rouge, and also in Minnesota and a couple other places throughout the country. So we just want to talk and open up the forum for discussion today. We also have H2O, who is the head of Balling for Peace, and you guys know he's on the mission to keep peace going, especially, you know, with our youth. So he's going to be joining us a little bit later on in the program as well. But before we do get into the panel, we do got a little bit of sports to discuss because, first of all, y'all know whenever my wifey for lifey, wifey boo, Serena is in the atmosphere, it's a W coming, and she did just come off of winning Wimbledon, the singles and the doubles in the same day, just so you guys know how real she is with herself. So we're going to talk about that. And my main man, Mr. Fundamental, Tim Duncan, decided to call it a career, man, in the best possible Tim Duncan kind of way as well. So
in the middle of the night, in the off season, you know, he's not exactly a very outspoken character. Mm-hmm. Didn't want all the attention like, you know, was given a Derek Jeter and Kobe Bryant well-deserved attention, but he's not about that life, apparently, and just does it in the offseason. Now, I think he did it, you know, from my understanding, he re-signed for another year with the Spurs. Mm-hmm. He took the player option, whatever the case may be, but after they signed Pau Gasol, he kind of realized Pau Gasol, LaMarcus Aldridge, he's on the way out. He didn't want to play a season where he's coming off of the bench. So yeah. I think it was, you know, the right time for him.
I would have liked to see him stay, though, for this season, just give him one more run. But that's just because I'm such a huge fan of Tim Duncan. But he is going, he said, when he felt like it wasn't fun anymore for him, then that's when he was going to step away. And, I mean, listen, it looked like Tim Duncan still had a little bit left in the tank. Obviously, he's not playing no 82-game season, but Pop hasn't played Tim Duncan 82 games in maybe 6-7 years. So, you know, but you got to tip your hat to that man, Tim Duncan, because, you know, just a great athlete, you know, the greatest power forward of all time, top, you know, 10 player of all time, 5 championships, 2 MVPs, 3 finals MVPs. Like, the man has pretty much done everything. The only person who can even rival him during his generation was Kobe Bryant, who also had a great career, also retired this season as well. But other than that, I mean, nobody came close to doing what Tim Duncan did while he was, you know, in the league with the Spurs. Made it to the playoffs every year that that he was in this league, which is amazing. Like, who does that? Who gets to the playoffs every year? At least 50 wins every year. So you got to love, you know, what Tim Duncan brings to the game of basketball.
And he actually, you know, the summer league's going on now. He was actually a first overall draft pick, and he played in the summer league that year, which is, mm-hmm. you know, very rare. You don't usually see that, you know, especially back then with the number one overall pick, you know, wasting time in the summer league. And he actually said he sucked during that time. So he, yeah. there was more development. And, players like it was Avery Johnson, you know, former coach and mm-hmm. former teammate with the Spurs. He said he saw a lot of potential in him because of his work ethic, you know, to do something like that. And he is by far the greatest power forward of all time. Even one of the other great power forwards, Charles Barkley, addressed that and said he was the greatest power forward of all time, and that was years ago, so there's, you know, not much of a debate with that. You might throw Karl Malone's name out there in the mix, but I personally think Tim Duncan definitely the best power forward of all time. So it's a shame to see him go. I'm with you, Trip Young. It would have been nice to see him go out with a championship, maybe go for one more year. But mm-hmm. like I said, I don't think he liked the idea of coming off the bench, and he wasn't going to try to make Pau Gasol or Aldridge come off the bench, because that just doesn't make sense. So
happy trails to you, Mr. Duncan. And don't worry, because you will be honored very soon. But we'll talk about that at the end of the program with Mr. Fundamental there. We got to talk about a little bit of football, because my favorite quarterback, Tom Too Cool, I think he's officially lost the fight. It's over. And he's going to...
he can still appeal it in the Supreme Court, whether they want to hear the case or not. And he might ask for it to be delayed, delay the suspension while they hear the case in the Supreme Court. But that's, you know, what's called a Hail Mary at this point. And I think Angel will probably know more about that than us, since he's the attorney on here. But how sick of you are, before any legal aspect of it, how sick of you are you of it that this is carried on for, I think, 562 days now?
That's a long time. It's just kind of ridiculous. It doesn't, I don't know, but the appellate process is the appellate process, and you know, he has that right. So why not pursue it? I would do it if I were him.
And take it to them. Listen, I'm all for it. I don't want Tom Brady to have to miss four games. What I was hoping would happen was he'll appeal it again, and they push it back, and he doesn't have to face the four-game suspension this year, plays this season out, you know, does great, and then retires at the end of this season. So no matter what, he doesn't have to face the four-game suspension. Everybody wins that way.
The only player to start opening game of the season, other quarterbacks, to do it more than him is Dan Marino, John Elway, and Brett Favre. And now he's obviously not going to catch up to those guys, considering he's most likely going to be suspended for the first four games. So.
That is correct. But that is Mr. Tom Too Cool, and you even make your bed, you must lie in it. So if he does wind up having to miss those first four games, it's okay, actually, because the Patriots will still probably win at least two of those games, even without Brady. And more than likely, they'll still win the division, because the Jets are horrible, the Bills are horrible, and the Dolphins are horrible as well. So I don't think the Patriots have any problem with Tom Brady being gone those first four games.
Yeah, I mean, they'll most likely go 2-2 with that one. But in other NFL news, tomorrow is the deadline for franchise tags to be, to sign contracts, extensions. If a deal isn't reached, then they either play on the franchise tag salary or not. Few list of players that still have not signed long-term deals. One of those is Eric Berry, who was honored last night in the ESPYs. He obviously recovered from cancer. He's a big part, not only as a player, but as a vocal and inspirational piece to the Kansas City Chiefs. So hopefully they get a deal done by tomorrow. So that's some of the other news in the NFL and the ESPYs. Speaking of the ESPYs, we will be having the RFRTs live here next week. That's our version of that's the real sports award. So you definitely want to be tuned in for that next week. But the ESPYs, the bootleg version.
Mm-hmm. You get to see myself and the Statman in a suit. Ladybug's going to have her dress on again. She might put the heels on for y'all. You got to love it, man.
It's definitely worth it just to, you know, see us all snazzies up alone, but it's going to be a great show. We're going to have some musical performances. You know, it's definitely going to be one heck of a episode, so you're not going to want to miss that next week.
Actually, this is a big surprise on the musical tip. You guys are really in for a treat.
We're not even going to spoil it.
Yeah,
so
you got to wait and see, but you guys are going to be happy. I promise you next week that you guys are going to be really happy when you see who's here performing for you guys and for the award winners. And like I said, the only person I can actually tell you who is being honored next week is Tim Duncan, because he's getting the Lifetime Achievement Award. So again, shout out to Mr. Fundamental, great career, and we here at Real Fans Real Talk, we appreciate what you brought to the game of basketball, and thus you will be honored with that Lifetime Achievement Award. But everybody else, you gotta wait and see. But it's going to be a fun one.
Yeah. Speaking of fun, John Cena had a lot of fun hosting the ESPYs yesterday.
Yes, he did.
Now, I am not a fan of John Cena. I was a fan in the beginning of his career, and then, you know, he kind of just became annoying. And, you know, his humor and the movie Trainwreck, I thought he was kind of funny. And, you know, then he did it better than any stand-up comedian I could think of.
Yeah.
He was just completely hilarious yesterday. Big surprise of the evening is the fact that John Cena did a hell of a job coaching and had jokes on everybody pretty much. So I enjoyed that.
Yeah, hilarious. I think my favorite was, actually I got two. My favorite was the comparison of Roger Goodell to Vince McMahon. And the fact that he said that Luke Walton was the best player on the Lakers.
Yeah, the head coach and the best player.
Yeah, he was the head coach and the best player. I thought that was hilarious. And he also mentioned the fact that he spent his entire career wearing jean shorts. So that was, you know, hilarious. So he got on himself as well.
I mean, he compared the WWE to other sports. Yeah. Like, you know, LeBron James being the hero, then the enemy, then the hero, like a face and an heel. And
Odell Beckham Jr. was Coco Beware minus the parrot. Yeah. For you older wrestling fans to go back to the WWF days, you guys know who Coco Beware is, so you can imagine the similarities between him and Odell Beckham Jr. So yeah, he definitely went in. So shout out to John Cena for that one. He is one of my favorite wrestlers still right now. So,
and even during the time when I hated him, you still like John Cena for some reason. I couldn't understand that, but he showed.
That's why, because he had the freestyle battles. You know, he would come battle the fans. He was rapping down the
fans.
Fans were all, you know, if Cena wins, we riot. When I was at the ECW event, and thankfully RVD beat him that night when I was there live many years ago. Because he was just corny for a while, and you still liked him. I don't know why.
I did, yo. That's my man, yo. You gotta love John Cena. He just came up. He came
showed
up
a lot
too.
Of character. So shout out to John Cena. He did a great job. One of the other great jobs is how they started out, thanks to New York Knicks Carmelo Anthony, and that started out on a very serious note. He, along with the Fab Four of Friends, there with Chris Paul, CP3. Dwayne Wade and LeBron James all opened up, starting with Melo, then CP3, then Wade, and then LeBron, going on in detail about all the tragedies going on in the world. And what did you take of it, Trip, with the ESPY starting out that way and the players speaking out?
Well, first of all, I commended Carmelo Anthony, because he actually led the way and went to the producers and said, this is what we want to do. And I mean, at this point, I don't even think that the producers could have said anything but yes to Carmelo Anthony, because you might have had a mutiny on your hands where you're going to turn down Melo, LeBron, Wade, and Chris Paul when they want to do something like this, you know, to kind of mellow out what's going on with the world and just get people to come together and just unify. I thought it was an amazing thing. We need more of it. You know, it brought me, you know, back to the kind of things that guys like Muhammad Ali, you know, was doing, you know, guys like Tommy Smith in the Olympics, and just we needed it. We're at a point where we really needed it, which is why, you know, today we brought together this you know, this panel, because it's something that was needed. And the fact that you have some of the most notable athletes in the world, most notable people, period, in the world, who are willing to put it all on the line and step up and fight for a cause, because, you know, at the end of the day, no matter if you're a police officer, you're a civilian, these people that are being killed, are related to somebody. So they have families, they got brothers, they got sisters, they got mothers, they got cousins, they got aunts, they got uncles, you know, so everybody is affected every time a life is taken unnecessarily. So the fact that these four gentlemen started the show like this with an amazing, impactful speech, you have to give them all the credit in the world. And I really hope that the rest of the sports community, you know, steps up and does their part as well, because, you know, people will listen. And it's sad, you know, they might not listen to, you know, the regular everyday person you see, you know, in the street marching. It sucks. But you will listen to your favorite athlete or your favorite entertainer or your favorite, you know, artist or your favorite television host when they're telling you these things. You know, it sucks that we can't just go by, you know, just the civilian saying this, but it's a beautiful thing that these guys have chosen to step up to the plate and take the lead, and they're going to continue. And I gained so much more, like, I mean, these are four of my favorite players anyway, you know, but I gained so much more respect for these gentlemen. Like, I will continue to support these guys long after their careers are over because of the fact that they chose to stand up in the way that they did on the biggest stage.
Now, Angel and Ladybug are not here just to look good, okay? We're going to get to them.
You look snazzy with the suit on, though.
Definitely, no question about it. Both are here looking good, but we're going to get to them and get their take on this fan mail question that Philip wrote in. Trip Young kind of already touched on it. So Philip wrote in, how important is it for stars like Carmelo Anthony to speak up in times like this? And, you know, me personally, I recently watched, like, the OJ documentary, or started to watch it in the first one. Mm-hmm. It was kind of like, you know, people in the civil rights movement were asking OJ to kind of speak up when things were going down. And he was just all about himself and the sponsorship deals. He didn't want to start problems or anything. And yeah, times were a lot worse back then. So he, you know, there's a possibility that somebody in the corporation or whatever might not like what you have to say, and, you know, it could cost you sponsorships or whatever. So, and especially in this day and age with social media, where people are going to hate on you no matter what side of the opinion you're on. Mm-hmm. So you'll be hated on whether you feel this way or that way, whatever the case may be. Somebody's going to hate on you. So to go out there and speak is definitely important. Like Tripp said, there are people that look up to them and might not listen otherwise. So, especially the youth. So, we'll start with you, Angel, though, on your opinion on what you think as far as celebrities speaking out.
Well, I definitely think it's important for celebrities to speak out. And of course, you know, you mentioned OJ, and back then that might have been risky for him. Whereas I think nowadays it's the opposite.
Yeah.
I think you're going to get more sponsors probably.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's one side of it. The other thing is that the cops, they love sports, you know, they're out there. So mm-hmm. if they're seeing one of their heroes talking, then maybe that might encourage them a little bit more. And not that they're not trying hard. There's a lot of them that are. Being a cop is a scary job.
Yeah.
It's definitely not something I would do.
Yeah. I agree with you on that.
Our rumor mill host covers the celebrities all the time and some of the stupid things that they do. But now, what do you think as far as them speaking out and other celebrities speaking out in general?
Well, all of you guys hit, you know, the main points on the head. Like, social media runs rampant. You know, every week I talk about it's a picture or it's, you know, something simple that gets blown up and taken to a whole nother level. And now with these things and these killings that are happening unnecessarily, it's, you know, it's good that these celebrities, these public figures, these quote unquote icons and legends really speak about it, because, you know, it's not only us, you know, the younger generation, you know, children, you know, with social media, they're following the next fad and the next, you know, big thing that's going on. And, you know, like you guys touched upon, you know, somebody that you may look as a, you know, a big figure, they're going to speak on something. It's like, you know what? Yeah, they make sense. And sometimes people agree and they don't even know why they're agreeing. Or people's just doing it because so-and-so said so. And maybe in this day and age, if that's what it takes to bring this positive change, then so be it. You know what I mean? It's, I feel like at this point in time, social media needs to take a turn for the better. It needs to be used the way it was intended to you, to connect with people on a positive note. And the fact that the internet is so vast, you do get ridiculed for any comment because you have people that come from different truths and different morals and different backgrounds and different cultures where, in a sense, they're not wrong, but you don't know that culture and they don't know yours. So it's a lot of miscommunication. So I feel like if these iconic figures that get recognized internationally speaks out, it brings forth a positive change.
I mean, there's a lot of bad things about social media, but the fact that social media is out there is kind of a weapon for the people to communicate what's going on. Because, yeah, you know, it could easily be hidden without social media. So the fact that it's there, it's a good thing, as bad as it is for society, in the sense of people hating on each other, and it's kind of like anti-social media in the sense that people mm-hmm. don't communicate the way that they should in person, on the phone, hearing each other's voice, whatever, as yeah. opposed to arguing over stupid things on social media. But it is a weapon for the people to communicate on what's going out there. So it is important. So in some countries, if you have your Facebook to kind of communicate what's going on, and if your account isn't secure enough, the government will come in for you speaking out, because it's not every country is a free country. So yeah. you going out there and speaking out and having it,
it's a big risk.
You know, the government seeing what you're saying, you know, they could, you know, come into your house and you know, take you away or whatever in some countries. So it is a weapon to get the word out there, despite what your thoughts are on social media. You know, there's pros and cons to everything, I guess. So. Yeah.
And I want to go back and touch on the point that Angel made about, you know, it, because a lot of times, you know, when we see these killings and we just, people get riled up and it's just us against the police. But, I do want to take time. We have to understand, like Angel said, it is a hard job being a police officer because your life is on the line. Every time you walk out of that precinct, your life is on the line. And, yes, there are a lot of bad cops. I looked at the numbers, and last year there were 905 deaths at the hands of the police in the country. So, you know, people, yeah. yes, and we never want to see an innocent person lose their life, but that goes for all people. You know, the cops that were killed in Dallas had nothing to do with Alton Sterling. They had nothing to do with Castile in Minnesota. You know, so we got to take those things into account.
Those,
you know,
905 people aren't all innocent people.
Right? Yeah, but just, yeah.
Well, if you want to hear numbers, is 102 unarmed, at least. This is just from the U.S. Census and mapping police violence.org. Mm-hmm. 102 unarmed black people in 2015.
And that's
102. Yeah. And that represents about 37% of the unarmed people killed by police. And you got to realize, you got to put that into context of there's only 13% of the population that's black.
Yeah.
So it's insane. You're saying that there's five times more black people getting killed than everyone else.
Yeah.
And that's not skewing numbers, because there's so many people out there putting out statistics and saying, oh, well, you know, 95% of people killed, well, black people killed are killed by blacks. But, you know, that's, you could skew those numbers however you want. But the reality is five times more people, more black people are getting killed than anybody else. And that's 2015. That's last year. Yeah. This isn't the 60s.
Yeah.
It's unfortunate. It's so unfortunate where you say, like you said, only 13% of the population. Like, yeah. And there's a lot of people. There's a lot of people in this world, and only 13%. It's like.
And this is why, you know, sometimes we got to take a step back. And yeah, you know, we understand that this is, you know, this is a sports show, you know, but we all kind of just sat back and said, sometimes you have to stop because there's things that's bigger than what's going on in the sports world, you know. And when you had the call to action from Carmelo Anthony, and he said to, you know, he directed it at athletes and told them, you know, we can't be afraid of losing endorsement deals. But when I heard his comments, I took it as bigger than athletes. I took it as anyone who is making a living off of sports in general needs to step up. And that was the main reason why, me personally, I wanted to have this panel discussion. Because if you're making a living off of these athletes, you know, and whatever, I mean, even if you're just the vendor at the hot dog stand at the stadium, you know, it's your job. It's our duty. These are human beings that are losing their lives. And I don't want it to be my nephew tomorrow. You know, God forbid. I don't want it to be somebody that's dear to me. I don't want it to be none of my co-hosts. I don't want it to, you know, I don't want it to anybody else to have to lose their life unjustly. So, you know, if we can do our part, this is a small thing here, but you know what? It might be big to somebody else, because the people that watch this, at least they'll know we're doing our part to help and change, you know, what's going on. And it's sad that we have to do these things. But you know what? When in times like these, we have to speak up. We can't lose any more people. It's crazy what's going on. And with the social media, like, it's bad that we have to sit and watch over and over again people being killed like animals, people being shot with children sitting behind them. That's unacceptable. You know, and it's time. And I, like I said, I completely commend Carmelo Anthony. He made me. I had some Knicks jokes this week, but I was going to use them for you, Stanley. But I said, you know what? I'm gonna let him go this week because of Melo. Well,
thanks, Melo, for not having me endure any further Knicks jokes from.
I'm gonna give you a month off.
That works for me. Well, not until the season starts, and you know.
All right. Yeah, then it's on. It's on.
If they start losing, then yeah. There you go. But sport. It is a sports show, but sports have had a huge impact on, you know, society and racism and the civil rights movement. You go back to the Joe Louis days, and mm-hmm. you know, he's somebody that, you know, white kids are watching and idolizing, and, you know, it has an effect. You know, he was fighting the German during the times of the World Wars and everything, so he was representing America, and he was, you know, he was black, and that kind of, you know, helps with racism. And you look at Muhammad Ali, obviously the same thing. You know, he's a hero for a lot of people. So, I mean, Jackie Robinson before that. I mean, yeah. If you're a fan of sports and you know, you grow up watching these, you know, black athletes and you're a fan of them, you know, chances are you're less likely to be racist. But, you know, some people are just, you know, racism is ignorant because you're not born racist. You're kind of going into it as racist. And it's probably a lot of times from bad experiences. Like, you could be, you know, a white person that has bad experiences with a bunch of black people. But that doesn't mean all black people are bad, but that person will be ignorant yeah. and just start hating black people, and vice versa. You could be, you know, a black person and have bad experience with white people and, you know, just white police officers, and automatically assume all police officers are bad. This is a very small percentage of police officers
yeah.
that are bad cops. And to go and say all the police are bad is stereotyping, the same way saying all black people are bad or all white people are bad. Yeah. So that's a stereotype in itself. And we got to stop with the stereotypes. And
I got a lot of police officers, you know, in my circle, that's family members, friends. So I know that not every police officer is bad. So I would never get up here and say all police officers are bad. You know, we can't blame everyone for the select few.
And speaking of police, I have black friends that are police officers. And, you know, when they're rookies, they're assigned to, you know, the bad neighborhoods, which is, you know, the least trained, the least experienced, and they're assigned to these bad neighborhoods. And even black police officers start hating black people that are in those high crime areas. And, you know, they start, you know, racial profiling, and even though they're black. So yeah. It's just...
And that's the thing that we have to bring to everybody's attention. It's institutional. It is, like, in our society as a whole, where we're putting a certain population on a lower scale. It's not, and it's everywhere. It's prolific everywhere. And a lot of it, yes, it's ignorance. It's people, they are not raised to know better. Yeah. They don't have those experiences. They're limited in their experiences. So yes, we can give them a little bit of a pass on that. But at the same time, it's
not necessarily a pass.
These are people. Yeah. We need to see people as people.
Yeah.
Not as anything else. Just people.
And that's what we're missing.
They're one of us.
We're missing out. And we're gonna go to our first video clip of the day. And this is actually, I shot this video a couple of years ago, a little bit after Eric Garner situation happened. An artist's name is Highlight. It's featuring Yachty. It's called No Resistance for Ferguson. So we're gonna jump into that video right now. And when we come back, we got Mr. Ballin' for Peace himself has just walked in the building, so we're gonna hear what he has to say about athletes stepping up in these trying times. But we're gonna jump into this video. Make sure y'all following us on the web too, realfansrealtalk.com, on Twitter, on Instagram @realfantalk, youtube.com/realfansrealtalk, and facebook.com/realfansrealtalk. Let's jump into that video.
And the cause of that effort.
Lay down your swords. Lay down your pistols.
So even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream.
Lay down your pistols. Call off your dogs.
Spirit awaken in our bodies. Grace get beside us. Patience get inside us. Satan get behind us. This nation's society's racially divided. Our biases blinded us. Sirens and fire trucks. Tyrants that fire and bust. Like, why won't you smile at us? Maybe I should walk in single file like a child does. Your time is up to silence them. Don't put your hands up. Put your Samsungs and iPhones up. Brandish cannons on candid cameras. Your damage is Instagramming and Vine viral by amateur cameramen. Ham and cheese sandwiches can't be the plan for us. Sergeant slaughter canvas and streets to meet quota. Not to keep odor. Shots on each corner. Got to be stronger. Mom's in the morgue. Morning, she just saw him this morning. Can't believe they murdered him. Can't believe there's tanks in the streets. Teleprompters and helicopters, but where's the emergency? Where's the sense of urgency? And this ain't Nazi Germany, that we're in, it's Ferguson.
Lay down your swords. Lay down your pistols. Call off your dogs. Show no resistance.
I ain't figuring bygones be bygones. I finger off the trigger on the camera icon. You can carry your fire armor, a camera tripod. You still get stopped and frisked like stop resisting. This is official militant business. I'll split the clip, you don't turn those camera lights off. The paparazzi should follow cops on the beat and not Beyonce. Harvey Levin, stop following Kanye. Follow moms in Chicago that lost their teens, record their screams. Let's let the world see it all. Vietnam free at last, we ain't free at all. Just when you thought that you seen it all, turn on CNN and see some more. Offer me to see the car, cigars in the convenience store. We could be more. Instead of songs about the loyalty of halls, need some more Jesus walk, some viable dialogue. Instead of gang slanging and violence and banging with silencers, need some more Lecrae, Common and Jay Electronica.
Lay down your swords. Lay down your pistols.
Those you put it next to the lady to fold the laundry, like, what are you? All right, we are back. You're live on Real Fans Real Talk. We're just joking around with the Alec Baldwin of Real Fans Real Talk.
Yes.
Saturday Night Live has Alec Baldwin, the common guest host. We have the one and only H2O, Haron Hargrave, joining
us. He's like
us
just
once again.
Taking my whole shot.
Always a pleasure to have you on the show, especially when you come bearing gifts. So it's always much better to, you know, and the Bowling for Peace brand is definitely something appropriate for this episode because it is all about bringing the peace, and the Bowling for Peace movement is a great thing that you're doing. So.
Well, Bowling for Peace actually started because of the whole Mike Brown situation, the Eric Garner situation. I wanted to do something in a positive light to get people to come out and support positivity. and not, you know, continue down that road of, like, you know, police bashing and things of that nature, you know, people are going to make crazy decisions. And we as people can't control other people. Like, if I can tell you not to do something or to do something, you know, then it would be a perfect world. You know what I mean? But I can't control other people. You can't control other people. Nobody can control other people.
Yeah, and some people are stuck in their ways. I mean, when you talk about racism, there's people who have been racist, you know, most of their lives. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you could go and protest all you want, do whatever you want, any number of athletes could go out and speak up, but they're still going to be stuck on their ways.
So. Yeah. And it's sad because, you know, there's a lot of good people out here, but then there's also a lot of bad people as well. So it's like, you know, goes hand, it's like 50-50. You know, and then there's some people who front and it's fake in front of you, and then, you know, behind your back, they're doing crazy stuff like Hulk Hogan. You know what I mean? Like, no, but on a serious note, like,
there are people just like that. You don't know who's racist, who's not racist, and I just think that's really, it's whack, man. It's so whack. You know what I mean? We're all human beings at the end of the day, regardless of your skin color. Like, you know what I mean? I watched those videos and it really, you know, it really touched me. I reached out to Erica Ford right after that and said I want my voice to be heard, not just on my my network and my people, but I want everybody to know how I felt as well. You know what I mean? Because it's a lot of these topics, a lot of these things come up, and I don't really talk about these matters, but they affect you, man. And if they don't, then, you know, you're just a stone cold person, you know. But you know, watching those videos, watching that one video, it was Sterling. It was just bad. You know what I mean? Like, what more do you want? What more? First off, anybody, when you get thrown to the floor from back, you don't know what's going on. You throw him to the floor. You have a knee in him. Like, you pinned down. His hands is, you know, even if he had a gun on him, he didn't have the gun and pointing it at you for you to shoot or anything like that. You got him down. You got him, you know. And then he got a gun. And then you shoot six times.
Yeah.
To hurt somebody, to wound somebody, you shoot him in the leg. If you know, they murdered that dude. You know what I mean? They murdered him.
You're a foot away of shooting somebody in the chest. That's and crazy.
Six times. Yeah. Boom, boom, boom. Why are you shooting so much? You're right on him. Here, if I have you knee down, two people on you, you know, it's, come on. Like, what is your psyche? What are you thinking? What are you going into a situation?
We have to call it what it is. It's cowardice. It's, you signed up. You chose to be a police officer.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not willing to risk getting hurt versus shooting an unarmed person, then you shouldn't be a cop. You should be the one putting your life on the line. You're the one that should be risking your life. If you think that they have a gun and you're not 100% sure, then why are you pulling that trigger? That's fear. That's fear. And if you have that fear, don't be a cop.
That should be the last option, to actually kill and murder someone. That should be the absolute last, and it should be in a self-defense type mechanism.
Because once you keep shooting, then it's like, now you're not even trying to just restrain this person. Yeah. Like, now your aim is to kill this person, so there's no possible way that he can combat you in this moment.
Anyhow, he would have lived. Those cops, they would have been sued. Like, the priest, everything would have been... And if these cops don't get off, man,
they'll still be sued.
If these cops get off, having it on video, what more do you need?
I mean, Eric Garner, the guy, got off on video.
Yeah, and that's the thing.
The chokehold has been banned for years. So, you know, 20 years, whatever the case may be. And clearly an illegal chokehold. Clearly, he said, I can't breathe, you know, God knows how many times. And, you know, the knee on the head, I mean, that was, you know.
My question for you, Angel, is in these situations where we clearly see what's going on, from the legal standpoint, can we do? Because there's a lot of people who every time we see one of these, and this is, I hear, you know, just being in different circles, that don't even feel like there's going to be justice. Like, they go, and anytime there's another person killed, their mentality is, oh, well, these cops are going to get off. So how do we change that?
Well, we'll start with a statistic. I mentioned that 102 at least 102 unarmed people were killed, unarmed black people were killed. Only 10 out of those 102 were there any type of prosecution. And I'm not talking about that they got convicted or anything, that there were charges pressed.
Yeah.
And that's ridiculous. But to be 100% honest when you're in that situation and you're dealing with police officers, and I tell you right now, I'm fearful myself. I'm scared every time I interact with police officers, and I'm not that dark.
I am too.
And that's wrong. We shouldn't fear. They're here to protect and serve. And they're not doing that. They're punishing people, I feel like. If you're executing a death sentence on someone when you pull that trigger, and that's making you judge, jury, and executioner all in one shot. And that's completely off base, and that's not your job. That's not what you're supposed to be doing. I understand you may feel there's a risk to the public, but in a lot of these situations, you got someone tied down on the floor, and you're saying there's a gun. It doesn't matter. He's tied down. He's on the floor, and you're like, come on.
It's rare that you have rebels. Horrible. Sorry to cut you off. It's rare that you have somebody that's going to be a rebel and just going out and guns blazing, shooting up, killing cops. First of all, when you see a police officer, you tame yourself. You calm down. Even if I'm driving, when I'm driving, I see a cop, I'm gonna go a little slower. I'm gonna, I'm gonna look. I'm gonna two hands on a steering wheel, everything like that. And it's like,
you don't want a ticket, let alone lose your life.
A lot of people don't feel that way, and especially in the light of everything that's going on. It's riling people up, and we have to be careful about that, because as a citizen, the police are questioning you. They want to arrest you. They can. They have that right. And you have to not resist that arrest. You give in. You put your hands up. And, of course, that still happens where, you have to be respectful to them. And usually you'll get that respect back. And that's not always the case. And for the most part, I had a situation. I was out on Fire Island, and we were, partying and whatnot. And there was a crowd that came out, and they were saying like derogatory statements, and my fiance got offended, and one of those guys came up to me, and they literally threatened me. They told me, said some really mean stuff to my fiance in front of my face, and then they had the nerve to put their hands on me, and of course I hit the guy, but he turned out to be a police officer. And that's insane. And I'm like, okay, well, if you're talking to people like this on a daily basis, if he would have identified himself as a police officer, I probably wouldn't hit him. That's the 100% honest truth, but because I would have been scared.
Yeah.
But he made me scared either way, so that's why I hit him, and he touched me, and that's
legal. Then he wanted to exercise his,
And then the police were called, and we had to deal with them, and, I identified myself. I'm an attorney. He threatened me. He did this. I was totally respectful, and the cop was being completely disrespectful to me, was screaming at me, was yelling at me, was yelling at my fiance, and people suffer from PTSD on a regular basis, so them spazzing out and reacting in a stressful situation is normal, and these cops need to be able to realize and deal with that in a way. And I was eventually able to calm the guy down and explain who I was and explain everything, and I got away scot-free because I was in the right.
Yeah.
And thank God the cop was reasonable. That's
rare.
That's really rare.
That's the problem. Well,
the attorney can help,
but of course. And the fact that I was there on a work function and all that, it was just like, okay, well, this is going to be a problem if we continue. But the deal is you have to be respectful. You have to not resist. You have to, and it hurts to do it. But I'd rather be that
and especially humble since person intentionally, trying to get a rise out of you by the way that they act.
Exactly.
Now, there's a video out there that, I saw on the internet of how to talk to police officers. You don't have to roll the window down. You could tell them, I hear you just fine. I don't consent to a search or whatever. Like, I don't know are you familiar with that video at all? Or
I have not seen that video.
But does that make any sense that you don't have to roll the window down and you could just reply with, I hear you fine?
I
I wouldn't advise anybody to do that. I would advise that you cooperate.
Yeah, that's what I'll be cool with.
You know, it, like, you do cooperate to a certain extent. You provide your papers. You provide. I have a military ID, so every time I present, I show it to them. You know what I mean? I give them all my documents, and I'm always 100% respectful, and, you know, I don't give them any kind of trouble because I feel like it's scary.
The reason why I ask is because, you know, people put that out there on the internet. I recently saw a video with a white 18-year-old who apparently had weed in the car, whatever, was smoking weed because the cops said he smelled it. He pulled it over because he said that it was subject to, like, a stolen car, like, or whatever, which wasn't true. He went and spoke to the guy, and the kid just said, "I could hear you fine." He didn't roll down the window. You know, to shorten up the story, you know, basically he wasn't cooperating. The cop opened the door. He ended up tasing him for what's six times the legal limit, which was like 23 seconds, I believe, or something like 24 seconds, whatever it is. And the kid has brain damage now. He pulled him out of the vehicle, dragged his body, and dropped him, like, in his head hitting, like, the sidewalk or whatever. So, I mean, it happens to, you know, not just black people. It happens to white people, and I think it's more of a rich and poor thing because in the poor white neighborhoods, they're, you know, doing this to people too. But at the same time, like you were saying, cooperate, and, you know, as much as it, you know, you might hate the police, try to avoid the situation as best as you can.
The first statement that should be coming out of your mouth is talk to my lawyer, or is get me an attorney if you can't afford one. Yeah. That should be the first words that always come out of your mouth when you're
That's
speaking
what I'm
to police.
Now when but y'all when? Call Angel Castro because he's my attorney.
Dude, you can say call Angel Castro.
But when though, like when they say
immediately,
license
and
registration.
If you had any interaction with the police, the first words out of your mouth is, "I have an attorney. Please speak to my attorney. You know, I'll
Even
give you the phone number. I don't care what it is. You say talk to my attorney." That's the first thing that comes out of your mouth. And then if they keep pressing you.
But
cooperate.
If they ask for an ID, you
cooperate. You still continue to cooperate. But the first words out of your mouth, that protects you now. Yeah. Because if they overstep in any way, then they shouldn't have been questioning you. They shouldn't be talking to you. And then the cops usually are trained well enough where they'll stop.
They stop me. They say license and registration. That's usually the first thing they say. I say talk to my attorney.
I would say, you know, sure, I'm going to get your license and registration. But you should speak to my attorney. I'm going to give you a phone number. Or, you know, I want attorney representation before you talk to me any further.
Okay.
But you have the normal, like, of course, they need to see your license and registration. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's a policing issue.
Should I never say, why are you stopping me? Like, what? Why did you pull me? Because they'll just pull you over.
You can ask them whatever questions you want, but I wouldn't even bother. I would just bring up the attorney, and that immediately is going to bring to their attention that you know something more than they probably think.
When you interact with the police officer and you cooperate with them, if they want to be a jerk, they're going to be a jerk to you.
Yeah.
So it's better that you just cooperate as opposed to, you know, just start to get ignorant and just go back and forth with the police officer because we know where that's going
to
lead.
Of course, but that's the thing. Like, if you're saying, okay, the window's closed, and sure, maybe you have a right to do that. Yeah. I can't tell you you have a right. Maybe you do. But if that's going to aggravate this police officer, why do that?
Why put your life at risk?
And you got to realize in just basic...
being arrested, the cop said yes, and he's still kind of, you know... I'm not justifying what he did because it was wrong. But.
Yeah, but like even like basic psychology is they're in a power position, so they're gonna like get high off of that either way, and that's just, you know, it takes a lot of training to just get rid of that. Yeah. They feel powerful, like the police officer coming up to me and putting his hands up. He felt like he just wasn't in uniform. Yeah. He didn't identify himself as a police officer, so.
But he still
the reaction.
Because
the reaction he got was completely
opposite. It's the fear. It's that cowardice, and like what you said earlier, if you're not emotionally prepared for this job, like it goes also with like doctors, people in the medical field, like people die every day at certain doctors' hands. Yeah. If you can't handle that emotionally, that's not the job for you. Like these police officers, you're supposed to protect and serve. If every time you go out into the field, it's like you're in a video game and anybody you see is like, mm-hmm. you know, that's not the job for you, because you can't separate, you know, your emotions from your job. Like, yeah, you have to separate that. If you have your own fears and your own personal insecurities and you're taking that into the business, it's the same like having any other job. Like, don't bring your outside issues inside. If you have your, you know, people have their, you know, secret prejudices and prejudgment about people, excuse me. If you take that into the workplace, where a lot of these officers do, yeah, it's their own personal thing. It's not something that's protocol. It's not something that they were trained or whatever they learned in the academy. This is something that they've been living with personally, like we said, the way they were raised or something like that. We don't know what these officers go through.
It could also be, like I mentioned before, and you're a rookie, you know, when you're a rookie, you're in bad neighborhoods or whatever, whether it be a white bad neighborhood or a black bad neighborhood, and you kind of start hating those people because they're committing crimes or whatever, and you know, some of the cops become ignorant. Some don't and realize that this is, you know, a small percentage of the people, and not all white people or not all black people or whatever the case may be. But back to the cooperating part, there's, you know, you pretty much have a close to a 0% chance, actually a 0% chance, if you know, get an attitude with the police officer and tell him, you know, get away from me, I don't want to deal with you. He's not going to say, oh, I'm sorry, sir, and walk back to his car. It's not going to happen.
It doesn't work that way.
So cooperate to try to avoid anything catastrophic, whether they're wrong or not.
Yeah.
You know, for your own safety, try to cooperate as much as possible. Sometimes it's not going to help, like you guys said, you know, if a cop wants to be, you know, messed up, he's going to be messed up. I mentioned with Tripp Young, there's this white couple, the wife was having a baby, you know, running low on time, but long story short, they pulled him over and he spent the night in jail, and they called an ambulance for the, you know, person who took 10 minutes, and the father spent the night in jail when his son was born, which is, you know, they just didn't want it because he didn't pull over right away because he wanted to rush to the hospital. So some cops just have no shame whatsoever.
I don't like police tactics, though. Like, even when you're driving on the highway, you're driving and they're hiding out and everything like that. And they're looking for someone to speed or looking for trouble. I feel like
it's a revenue stream, which is the problem, because
that's not right. Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? If you catch somebody doing something, that's cool. But don't be in the cut and you're hiding out.
They have their quotas. They have to make their money. A friend of mine who's on the force told me when the police had that little strike and they weren't given just moving violation tickets, that the city was losing a couple million dollars a day just from not giving out moving violations. So they have to, I mean, you know, they got to get that money from somewhere. They got to fill those quotas.
The positive wants to pulled this BS with Vision Zero, which is why they lowered it from 30 to 25.
Like, oh, man.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous, so you can get more tickets. It's more like, yeah, you're driving, like you're doing, you're supposed to be doing 25. Like, are you serious? Like, I feel like even, I have a detective car. One of my former coaches, every year he gives me his detective car. And that saved me from a lot of just, you know, they just pull you over for no reason. I can't count how many times I get pulled over for just driving, like literally, like, and that's why I say, what should I say when I'm getting pulled over? Because it's like, I just give them my ID and give them my detective card and they let me go. But some of them get mad, they get frustrated because they're like, man, I could have got it.
Because they know,
you know, that, it's like they would have let, you know, it's like,
what's shameful too is, I don't know, I was talking to one of my friends and he's like, oh, I get pulled over all the time. But you know what? If you look at all the tickets that I've gotten, if you pull up my DMV record, it only happens uptown in Spanish Harlem, where I live. It's like I drive everywhere else. I'm all over the world constantly. I'm almost never, unless I'm coming home, in my neighborhood driving. And, you know, why are they targeting
this area,
the minority, heavy, concentrated areas? Like, that's when you say tactics, like, I don't mind you hiding out on a highway and you catching somebody speeding. That's fine. But if you're hiding out only in minority neighborhoods, then there's something wrong.
I don't go.
Why don't you get that many tickets downtown in the financial district?
Yeah.
I could be pulling some wild and Yeah. Never get a ticket.
All right. With that being said, though, I want to get back a little bit into these athletes, because Haron, you do play professional basketball, mm-hmm. and the job of a professional athlete in these kind of situations. But before, I want you to hold off on your answer. Okay. Think about it. We're gonna go to another clip from retired WBA welterweight champion of the world, Aaron Davis, who is going to who spoke about Muhammad Ali, the activist, and about, you know, what boxers should be doing during these times. So we're going to jump into that clip in a minute, and then when we come back, Haron, I want you to answer that question. Mm-hmm. All right. Make sure you got
My name is Aaron Davis, ex-welterweight champ of the world, and I'm talking to a few friends about Muhammad Ali as a great man, a great fighter, and a great activist. I mean, he was for his people. I mean, he loved everybody. He wasn't a racist, but he was for his people, because black people at that time was being put down and given crumbs. I mean, he did every and anything he can do to support black people. Today, we need the need for fighters to step up, like Muhammad Ali. I mean, top fighters that people are going to listen to. Like Ali, he was a fighter that people listened to.
Was one thing, and most of, say, is that,
and 99.9% of stuff he said was correct.
All right. Welcome back. Thanks again to Aaron Davis. If y'all do want to step your boxing skills up, y'all better go over to Morris Park in the Bronx, where the Stat Man trains out of. You know, that's the WBA welterweight champion right there. And I want to let Haron answer that question about athletes and their responsibility.
I feel we have like a huge responsibility as athletes, because we do have the stage in the presence, and we have people who follow us. And I feel like what Carmelo Anthony did was very, very, very thoughtful. He made some, it was acknowledgeable. He wanted to make it to where everyone saw him on that grand stage at the ESPYs, yeah. And that was the best possible way to do it. And he went out and made sure that they did that. Exactly. You know, because they probably would have, you know, somebody said one or two things and that would have been it. But he made it, and he had his other brothers up there with him, too. And I think that was a great step in the right direction. And if we have more athletes like that, I think that, you know, just putting light to it.
Yeah.
You know, it can only help. It can only help before the athletes get behind us.
And that's what Aaron Davis was saying in that video. Angel, really quick, I know you wanted to say.
Just on a last thought, like we were talking about what you can do. Maybe not in that situation where you're being questioned by police, but if you see somebody else getting pulled over, you see somebody else that's dealing with the police, stop and watch. Mm-hmm. Cop watch. Just sit there and watch them and make sure the police know you're watching.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that brings more awareness.
I actually did that. I'm going to say it real quick. I actually did that, and I was recording, and the cop was putting his flashlight like this. Like, you know, so it couldn't really film. I'm like, dude, like... Yeah. Yeah. You know, so he's like, what do you stand? I'm like, I'm just
afraid to film too, because the cops sometimes might, they don't know if they're going to confiscate the phone.
I was in Miami once, and it was a white girl complaining about a black guy grabbing her or something like that. And then when he was like being arrested, she pulled out a camera and they arrested her. And it was just like, whoa. But so, you know, be careful with pulling a camera, but letting them know you're watching and staying a safe distance away.
Yeah,
it just brings up the awareness. It brings up, they know, okay, well, now he got witnesses.
Yeah.
So let's out of time. Thanks to our loyal Angel Castro for joining us, H2O.
Thank you for having me.
Tripp Young, thank you for joining us on this edition of Real Fans, Real Talk, and we'll see you next time, everyone.
Make way for the Rifties.
Everything you like.
Be safe out there.
Real fans, realtalk.com. With Arthur Thomas, Tripp Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend the CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. Real fans, realtalk.com. Got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Did Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log on to the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor, tell him Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter, tuning in should be the only